leaves a note and starts to choke. Can feel the lump that's in her throat. It's raining and she leaves her coat in silence.
We're sorry but we disagree. The boy is burning, can't you see? We're drowning sins in misery and ripping out in history.
Hello out there, my name is Kate and welcome back to my channel. In today's Friday the 13th video, I am going to be telling you about the Rosewood Center and the Rosewood Girls. Just a disclaimer before we start, unlike my Halloween video, the sources all had different information. I don't know if all of these facts are completely true. There probably is more information in Maryland, which is where our story takes place. And like my other video, I do have the notes displayed on my laptop. In March of 1888, the Maryland legislature approved an act, specifically Chapter 13 of the Acts of 1888, to establish and incorporate an asylum and training school for the feeble-minded of the state of Maryland that would receive, care for, and educate all idiotic, imbecile, and feeble-minded persons. Now, a feeble-minded person is someone with a mental health issue or a mental disorder. I do have anxiety and I talk about that. The word feeble actually means lack of strength, so I do not like this word. I'm only using it in this video because that's what the text of the legislation said. And going along with that act, the original name for the Rosewood Center was the Asylum and Training School for the Feeble-Minded. Now, this training school was a state-run institution or an asylum for children with developmental disabilities. So it was essentially a psychiatric or a mental hospital. And they did have a very restrictive admission policy from the State Board of Health because of inadequate housing. So they really only took in people who they thought could use the tools or just use what they were taught at the asylum and go out into the real world and support themselves. The first superintendent of the Rosewood facility, then called the Asylum and Training School for the Feeble-Minded, was Dr. Richard Gundry. And he was the superintendent until the 1960s, and he was previously the superintendent of Spring Grove State Hospital, which is another state hospital, like mental hospital in Maryland. And he believed basically everything opposite of what was already established in the psychiatric field. He believed that patients needed to be outside for a specific number of hours a day, and that restraints were not necessary. He also had the belief that good care and a sense of feeling involved and important would give these patients a sense of satisfaction with their lives. So when it opened in 1888, the asylum was free for poor children ages 7 to 17 who could not thrive on their own in the real world. And it was $250 for other children. The boys were taught farming, gardening, and carpentry, and also how to put out large fires because they did have 537 acres of land. And the girls were taught sewing, knitting, washing, sweeping, dusting, basically housekeeping and domestic service tasks. The board had an obsessive desire for the asylum to be self-supporting. So when the boys were taught farming and gardening, it was for food. And when the girls were taught how to sew and knit, they were making the clothing that the patients wore. Now, the farm that they were using stopped operating in the 1960s, but before then, in the 1920s, there was a spring fair at the Rosewood Center where the patients could sell their scarves, mittens, wooden items that they created. And they were able to actually keep the money that they earned for use when they were released. Now, this is where it gets a little suspicious. So in 1896, a private donor funded the construction of Tom Cottage, T-H-O-M Cottage, and it was used as a school for epileptic children. Then in 1904 and again in 1907, the Maryland State Legislature passed bills to transfer all insane and feeble-minded patients from county to state institutions like Rosewood, which really just ensured that the institution would still get state funding. From 1911 to 1933, 166 patients, mostly women and children, but a few boys as well, left Rosewood under habeas corpus writs and were subject to human trafficking bought by the rich, and they were treated absolutely horribly. They were abused, they were sexually abused, they were overworked, they were underfed, and some of the patients that were released, died 2 to 3 years later from acute pulmonary tuberculosis. And those patients that were released under habeas corpus writs were called the Rosewood Girls. So the rich were basically helping themselves to the girls by adopting them. The housewives that bought the patients told the girls that they should be thankful for what they had done for them. One woman actually collected, I'm gonna do this a lot in the video, one woman collected 35 Rosewood girls, and when they complained about her daughter, who would literally spit on them, they were simply tossed out onto the streets. The rich housewives, whenever they became dissatisfied with the girls, they simply ordered another girl, and presumably they went through lawyers to get another girl. Austrian physician Leo Kanner denounced the scandal in front of the American Psychiatric Association in Pittsburgh on May 13th of 1937. Now, Leo Kanner was the head of the Child Psychiatry Unit at Johns Hopkins University, an advocate for the feeble-minded, and he actually discovered autism, and it was first known as Kanner syndrome. Kanner's theory was that housemaids were very expensive, so the rich came up with a scheme to get cheaper help. They would file a writ for each girl without the girl's knowledge until the day that the court ordered the girl to a hearing, and they were released from custody to women who they didn't know and women who didn't know them. And these girls did not want to leave the asylum. They had been there anywhere from 5 to 30 years. Leo Kanner investigated this case with social worker Mabel Cross, and they found that a majority of the former residents were housemaids to the rich. Kanner and Cross were actually able to track down 102 of the 166 habeas corpus cases on record. 11 of the girls had died from illness or neglect. 17 had infectious diseases, 8 were reinstitutionalized in mental hospitals, and 6 were imprisoned for serious crimes. Today, this is a story of how destructive an upper class with an unchecked sense of entitlement can be, and how vital it remains to safeguard the interest of those who cannot do so for themselves. In 1912, it was renamed the Rosewood State Training School. And in 1943, the physically handicapped were admitted. Shortly after that, Rosewood suffered overcrowding and shortness of staff. So nurses went from caring for 6 patients all the way up to 32 patients at a time. And this caused unsatisfactory patient conditions that were eventually reported to newspapers in the 1940s and made into stories. In 1949, there was a title in the Baltimore Sun titled Maryland's Shame about state hospitals, not just Rosewood. Later in the 1950s, grand jury reports implied that Rosewood needed to focus on better rehabilitating and deinstitutionalizing patients and improving conditions for lifetime care patients. In 1950, the age restriction was removed, and in 1961, it was renamed Rosewood State Hospital. After this, the capacity at Rosewood expanded to up to 2,700 patients by 1968. A year later, in 1969, the State Health and Mental Hygiene Departments merged, and it was renamed the Rosewood Center. Now, also during this time, in the 1950s through the 1970s, many state-run institutions in the U.S. had reports of malpractice, neglect, and abuse. And in 1981, the U.S. Justice Department actually declared that Rosewood residents failed to receive minimally adequate care. And in 1981, the U.S. Justice Department actually declared that Rosewood residents failed to receive minimally adequate care. This also led to buildings being condemned in 1989. Now, a little closer to the present, in 2006, the main building was burnt in an arson case and went under security monitoring. On January 15th of 2008, the state of Maryland announced that the institution would be closed and that residents would be transferred to other facilities. 2 months before Rosewood closed, there were 130 incidents of abuse, neglect, mistreatment, and injuries. There were also allegations of failure to protect residents from harm, illegal use of restraints or seclusion, sexual abuse, and inadequate care, which all of those combined eventually closed Rosewood for good. A year later, on March 8th of 2009, one of the vacant buildings was actually destroyed in a fire in another possible arson case. They didn't try to put the fire out because the building was already set to be demolished. On June 30th, the state of Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene officially closed Rosewood. Now, if you're wondering what happened to this property, the Rosewood Center actually borders Stevenson University in Maryland. So on June 8th of 2017, they were granted permission to acquire the Rosewood Center and turn it into an educational and athletic site. And they also might be creating a memorial to commemorate the history of Rosewood Center and its patients. Now, I didn't mention this, I always said patients, but a lot of these sources called these patients inmates because of how they were treated. Now, there's actually a 2017 film called The Institute, and it is loosely based on a girl's experience at the Rosewood Center. Just another little disclaimer, this is a thriller mystery film that is rated R for bloody violence, graphic nudity, and disturbing content. Now, in the photos I uploaded from the website Abandoned America, when those photos were taken, 200 patients still remained at Rosewood. So they went through like the abandoned buildings, but there were still patients living there in other buildings. One of the sources said that in Annapolis, Maryland, at the Maryland State Archives, there are photos illustrating the care of Rosewood residents and records related to patients and the administration of the hospital. I will link the sources I have down below, like I did for my Halloween video. One of the sources actually has a video that you can watch, and it's an hour-long video, and it actually compares Rosewood to other institutions in Maryland. There's a huge difference. A reporter went into Rosewood and found that the patients had horrible hygiene, and a carer actually said that the sinks didn't work and that there was a broken pipe. But when the reporter turned on the sink, it worked fine. The sinks were just covered in dust from not being used in so long. In some of the buildings, the inmates were actually locked in a basement room with nothing to do. And there was supposed to be like a recreation period where toys were brought out and they could, you know, have a little bit of fun, have something to do. But while the reporter was there, there was no recreation time. And one of the recreation rooms was actually splattered with human waste. So they were not clean. Now, I've told you some very bad things about Rosewood, but it did actually help some people. It wasn't horrible for everybody. And I personally, based on the video and everything that I've read, I think that the buildings were actually based on IQ. The higher IQ you had, the better you were treated. The people with the higher IQs were treated reasonably and were actually being trained and cared for. They can wear their own clothes, whereas the other inmates had to wear the clothes provided by the institution, by Rosewood. They went to school on the ground so that they could learn and get an education. And they, in the video, it said that the girls were treated so good because they learned how to not be a burden to the staff. Now, if you have any mental health issues or like a mental disability, you are not a burden. You are not a burden. I don't know who needs to hear that right now, but you are not a burden. So the source with the video actually also has a photo album and some documents. There's one document titled A Demand for Closure. It's basically all the reasons why Rosewood was closed. I'm also gonna link some YouTube videos down below of people like walking around. They're both uploaded in 2019, so I'm not sure when these people went to Rosewood. Also, the address for Rosewood, before I forget, if you want to look it up for yourself, it is 200 Rosewood Lane in Owings Mills, Maryland. The zip code is 21117. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope that you enjoyed. Remember to like and subscribe to be notified whenever I upload, and I will see you in 2 weeks with another new video. Bye! People marching to the drums, everybody.